My void will consume you, if you ask nicely.
Your will is no longer your own.
Stay away from the food. To us!
For the Horde!
You have led the Horde to a place without honor.
Your petty quarrels only make me stronger.
Our world needs us, champ.
You got Julia in.
We cannot let the world fall to darkness.
Already lost.
Put your faith in the light, and all is possible.
Is it truly righteousness that drives you? I wonder.
It would seem you have guessed.
They are coming for you. This is the Whispers of Wars.
Hello everyone and welcome to Whispers of War, show 117. I'm your host Syl, and let's just jump into how were my 2 weeks in World of Warcraft? As you might have noticed, the show wasn't brought out last week. I took a week off because, it's basically been a rubbish 2 weeks in all fairness. I started the year off great with feeling really, really sick. Just really sore throat, and as we all know, a sore throat is rubbish for podcasting. So I was trying to be nice to myself and not do more damage than there already was. And then this week I fell down the stairs, so you know, it's been an amazing year already. I guess it can only go up from now on, I hope. I hope it doesn't get any worse. Anyhow, how has my 2 weeks in WoW been? Unfortunately, because I fell down the stairs, I wasn't able to sit for very long periods of time. I couldn't sit in one position for a long time, but for the moments that I did manage to play a bit, I actually I took a step back from raiding at the moment, just because I'm not feeling the love with the mage anymore. I don't know what it is, but there's something that is just not quite doing it for me, and I don't know. I don't know what it is. I wish I knew, because then I could fix it. But I tend to do what I always do when I don't feel the love with that character anymore. I jump to an alt. Which in my case, you know, plenty of choice. But I wasn't quite sure what I wanted to play. And I thought, you know what, let's go back to the first ever character class I made, which is Druid. And let's just see if I will enjoy it, because you know, if I don't like feral, I can go balance. If I want to try a bit of healing or god forbid tanking, I can try and do that. And as Twitter has reassured me, apparently bear tanking is one of the easier ones. So I thought, you know what, let's do this. I mean, I've played this class for years until I switched over to a few other classes, so I should be able to, you know, pick it up after playing it for at least 10 years. So, yeah, I'm actually really enjoying it. My only gripe is that I have two druids. Actually, I have a lot more, but on the alliance side, I have two druids. And my Night Elf druid is a reincarnation of my very first character I ever made. So, for those who don't know, I created a Night Elf druid, 17 years ago now, and played her, but that was back in the day when there weren't server transfers, and when the first RP PvP server came up, I had already managed to get it to level 60, but I really wanted to play on that server, so I just decided to roll on that server and created a new druid, did everything, and that druid has been my main character for years on end. So I don't really want to not play her, but I also really like my Worgen druid, which I have now. So I've decided to, and okay, this is me being really insane, I've decided to level them both. I'm focusing on the Worgen first and see if I can maybe raid with her, and then I will use my Night Elf more for PvP. Not that I'm an amazing PvP'er, but I do like the occasional battleground on the druid. So Yeah, I'm just going to try a different with those two, and at least it will make it a bit more interesting. So yeah, that's what I've been doing with the with the druids. I'm still playing the mage because I do want to go through the campaign with her. I mean, she's done the most in Shadowlands at the moment, so I don't want to just get rid of all of that. And I do enjoy doing Thorgast on her, and you know, everything that I have done on her, it's fine. I just don't particularly like raiding on her, so that's it. Even jumped into a few dungeons. It's surprising that I've done it because I don't know, but over, you know, back in the day, I didn't care about how I would perform in groups at all with strangers. I didn't give a shit if people were nasty. I was just like, yeah, I'll fucking meet you. But I don't know what has happened with age, and I've become more and more anxious about it, which I shouldn't have to be, really, because in all fairness, most of the time you just jump into a dungeon and no one talks at all. No one says a fucking thing, so I don't even know why I would get anxious. But yeah, that's also how I've been leveling. So dungeons a bit, and world quests, and you know, the threads of fate. That's how I'm doing it mostly now. Maybe the occasional battleground in between, which is very sad on Alliance, I have to admit. Maybe this is something I should do more on my Horde characters, leveling. Maybe winning battlegrounds is more fun than losing constantly. Sorry, Alliance, I'm not dishing on you, but don't know what's going on. It's not pretty. And I've gone Night Fae again. I'm you know, for aesthetic wise, I have to with my druids. It just fits. I can't see them going anywhere else at all. So yeah, I just went Night Fae again, and I quite like that. What is it? It's not Kindred Spirit, is it? No, it's the other one. The Night Fae ability for druids. I really, really enjoy that. So yeah, I thought, why not? Why not just do something that I do enjoy? And in all fairness, yeah, travel form in the mall is pretty nice. Quite enjoy that. So that's really how my period has been in World of Warcraft for the last 2 weeks. So yeah, we're just taking it slow, you know. I still have 2 years to go with this expansion, so I don't want to burn out. And who knows, once I feel confident enough with the druid, maybe in due time my guild will be happy for me to join them in raiding again. We'll see. Yeah, so a little bit different. Not one guest this week or this week's show. I actually have a roundtable. So we recorded this actually before the new year. But we are pretending as if it's going to be the new year now. Because it will be the new show for 2021. But yeah, I have a lovely roundtable. And we talk all about our first impressions of Shadowlands. And I will see you on the flip side, and we'll talk a little bit about what your favorite zone is in Shadowlands. So I'll see you on the flip side. And today, the first show of 2021. It can only go better from here. God, we hope so. I hope so. I start the year very, very amazingly so with a roundtable. And of course, a roundtable is not something I can do by myself. That would be very sad if I try to do that. So I have three lovely guests with me today. Some familiar faces, some not familiar yet. We'll get there. But I have three new people, and I'm going to introduce them all separately first. So I have Jared.
Hello.
Hello. And I have Squid.
What's up?
And I have Ali.
Hey.
So we have a good representation here. Two from Europe and two from America. I thought that would, you know, balance it out a little bit. But we are going to talk about the first month of Shadowlands and if it was everything we hoped for. You never know, you know, maybe it was right the thing that we needed in 2020. Or maybe not. We'll see. But first, I'm going to let them all talk a little bit about themselves, who they are, what they do, what they play, all those things. So let's start with Jared.
Okay. Hi, my name is Jared. I started playing World of Warcraft back a little bit before Wrath, but I consider myself to be a Wrath baby.
Mm-hmm.
I say that I've been playing through the entire time over the last, how many years is it since then? Like 12 years? Is that right?
That already sounds like so much. Like
so many years.
So many years.
I have played through that entire time on and off at some points, but for the last couple of years, I've not broken my subscription just because I love the game that much. What I'm playing right now is my Death Knight, who has gone Necrolord, because of course.
It does seem to make the obvious sense for a lot of people who play Death Knights that they go Necrolord. That's yes. What I hear.
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much for that. What about you, Squid? Why don't you tell the listeners a little bit about who you are and what you do?
Yeah, thanks. Hi, I'm Squid. I have been playing since January of 2007. I got sent by the U.S. Navy TAD to Pensacola, and guess what? In January at the beach, there's nothing to do. So I asked one of the locals what they did, and they said World of Warcraft, and I said, what's that? And that was 13 years ago, I guess almost 14 years ago next month, and been playing way more on than off ever since then. And for Shadowlands, so far, I've decided to, for the first time ever, main a paladin. Mm-hmm. I took Kyrian, same thing, kind of, you know, because I had to. Not really, I didn't have to, but, you know, for the way I play the game and the way I saw the storyline, I just felt like it was the right way to go.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you very much for that. And finally, Ali.
Hey, I'm Ali, and I've been playing WoW since mid-BC. On, have never stopped playing since. Never unsubbed, which is crazy if I think about it, how many years that's been already, more than a decade.
Don't think about the sub money. Don't think about that. Don't add it up.
Oh, no, I'm not even paying for the game anymore. Like, come on, we have gold for that.
That's true.
Which I spend more than I should, but it's okay. It's not bad to have 50k only at a time, but it's okay. For Shadowlands, I do have one of every single class maxed out as usual, but for your sanity's sake, I'll just focus on my paladin, which I have been adoring. I don't think I've loved my holy spec this much since Dragon Soul, when it was like the god mode. Okay. And she's Kyrian, obviously, because I'm a Kyrian at heart, IRL and in-game, so sorry.
I don't think you have to be sorry about that. I think many a paladin and priest have codes and Kyrians. Right, so guys, we are going to start talking a little bit about Shadowlands and how I figured out that most of the time it works best is if I ask the question and then I will call someone's name who volunteers then as tributes who will answer the question, and that's how we start to do it, just for our own sanity. But with anything with my interviews, we know how much I like to go off the path, so I have no doubt that will happen. So let's just start with the first week. That first week when we all waited and logged in, whether that's going to be at midnight or not, you know, it depends a little bit where you are or if it was the afternoon. And did it live up to your expectations? You know, what did you think went really well in that first week? And what was maybe not so good that you were like, holy fuck, what the hell? And was there anything that really surprised you, maybe going into that first week of Shadowlands that you didn't anticipate? Or just, it could even be like NPCs or storylines that you didn't anticipate. Now, I am going to say, if we are going to do anything about recent stuff that has been released, that is spoiler territory, and we will give a little bit of a warning there. So I'm sure that my guests will be happy to call out something like, ooh, spoiler, and then, you know, you have to go a little bit ahead. Anyhow, so the first start, did it live up to anything? Let's start with you, Squid.
Yeah, I mean, I thought the launch process went really smooth for us. It was I believe 5 p.m. Mm-hmm. on a Monday is what it released for us. So, you know, I was the original release date for me had the vacation lined up and everything, and then the pushback really hurt me, honestly. I know we can't play a game that's not ready, right?
Mm-hmm.
But when it pushed back, it pushed back into fourth quarter, and that October, November, December is the busiest time of the year for me. So, you know, the company that I work for doesn't allow time off. Mm-hmm. So for me, it was a real downer. You know, I enjoy being able to get in that first week, take vacation, and just go at it in every sense of the word, whether it be leveling or just testing everything out. And I wasn't able to do that. I was still able to get, I think I was the second max level character in my guild, even without being able to have the vacation. So that was fun. But it went smooth, you know, as far as I'm concerned, from a launch standpoint. I didn't continually get DC'd. I wasn't falling into the nether. There was no random ending up in the Northern Barrens like mm-hmm. I've experienced in the past. So it was, from a software, hardware state of mind, I think it went really well. I think we all still would probably agree that there's still a lot of, you know, glitches and what we would consider beta type issues that are being hammered out. Could it have been better? Sure. I mean, everything can always be better. But I do believe that they did a great job, even with the pushback, and we got a product that was playable. And it's been super fun.
Yeah. Okay. That's good to hear. What about you, Jared?
I second everything that Squid said. The launch, at least for me, I know that there were a lot of people that even in my guild, there were a lot of people that got hit with like server queues, like the authentication servers weren't working properly at points. People definitely had a rough time in the first like 24 hours getting into the game. That's like, I hate to say this, but that's kind of to be expected of any online game, especially one that, you know, makes huge changes like launching an expansion. Those things kind of just happen. It sucks and it shouldn't happen, but kind of have to take it for what it is. But the first week for me of any expansion is always the most magical time. Like, it's what I look forward to the most out of any other time during the game's lifespan, because it's, you know, you're getting in and you're seeing new content that that people have poured their hearts and souls into for years by the time it gets to our desks.
Mm-hmm.
And I was fortunate enough to get into the beta this go around. Very early on, I think I was actually in the alpha, so there wasn't really a whole lot mechanically that I hadn't seen already, because I played as much of the beta as I could, just to make sure that Blizzard was getting, you know, good feedback and all that. So on that front, I wasn't really surprised by anything. However, all of the cutscenes through the leveling process floored me.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it pulled me in to the experience of the game in a way that I haven't been pulled in since Wrath of the Lich King.
Wow, that's a big thing.
Like, I'm more into this game than I was in Legion, which I consider to be the best. Like, overall, the best expansion that they've ever made. I consider Shadowlands, at this point, to be better than Legion. That could change by the end of it. It could definitely change, but I'm going to say it here now. I think Shadowlands is top dog.
Okay, good to hear. What about you, Ali? How did it go for you? Because you're on you know, the continent, as I like to call it. How did that go for you?
Well, I was on Draenor at that point. Spoiler, yes, I did move after all, because I took the transfers like exactly the day before they would like go off, so they would take them away. Because I tried, and the first day was actually super okay. I didn't log in at launch. I logged in like a few hours after because I was busy sleeping. And then I couldn't sleep anymore, and I was like, yeah, you know what? I want to go play. And one might think that I would actually, you know, go in and play and, you know, level like everyone else. Yeah, I took my druid and I did herbalism. It was amazing. Everyone was just running around doing quests and all the herbs, all the ore, just for me. It was awesome. And the prices. Can we have those prices back?
This is basically your tactic of how to make gold in that first period, Rene.
Yes.
Okay, now we know for the next expansion, guys.
Guys, I bought in the first 3 days 5 WoW tokens, so...
Wow. That's, so, yeah. That's impressive. You've done well.
Oh my.
The prices were insane. Like, the Eternal Crystals were going for... On Draenor, they were going for, like, 15k. I'm not joking. It was insane. But then they tanked, obviously, the next few days, so I tried to roll in as much gold as I could, like, the first hours, because I know that's the time that you need to just push it. But the experience overall on a super high pop server, very, very unpleasant at peak times. Very, very unpleasant. Mm-hmm. Like, I remember I had to go to the store one day, and I sat mom in front of the PC, and I told her, make sure I don't get logged out. Press space, just keep me logged in for 20 minutes. Because it was like 7 p.m. and I was like, no, I'm not waiting 5k people in queue. Like, I'm not crazy.
Mm-hmm.
But after I moved, I was very upset because I do love my server. But the experience on the new one is actually much more enjoyable. The prices are still decent, so you can still make gold. There's no lag, there's not that much competition. You still get people to do quests if you need to. So it's amazing. It's really, really good. Is it just like Legion? I still love Legion because it had the Mage Tower, so Torghast still needs to impress me.
Okay. I've heard several opinions about Torghast in that respect as well. I think it also depends on your class and how you like to play the game at times. So, quick question for you guys, which is not on the list, but we all knew that all of a sudden we heard that Shadowlands was going to be pushed back, and we had, you know, to either change plans, or sometimes holiday was not doable at the time of this launch, like Squid said, or that was the same case for me, because November, December are very hectic for me at work, and I'm sure that a lot of people had the same thing. Now, I'm wondering, because the overall consensus for this is that the pushback was, as much as we didn't like it, it didn't damage the game because the game was released and it seemed reasonably all right. It's been conceived as, like, quite positive. Now, if you look at a game like Cyberpunk, which has been delayed, and then, you know, it was released, and, you know, people were not overly impressed with what was released, at least not on console. For PC, I can't say. I think that the opinions are a bit divided on that. But do you guys feel like, one, Blizzard, did they make the right call in pushing it? Even though they have upset some people, because I know that some people were very, very upset. You just have to go to the forums just to read that. But was it something that eventually did the game more good than bad? What is your opinion? Who wants to say something about this?
I think it did worlds of good, more than it actually hurt anything. Like, having a game delayed isn't necessarily a bad thing, and I like that you bring up Cyberpunk, because that's a game that's been delayed and delayed and delayed and delayed some more.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's like nothing bad against CD Projekt Red, but I think that they may have bit off more than they could chew with what they wanted to do with the launch of that title. But contrast that with Shadowlands, with what Blizzard gave us. They delayed it once. They apologized profusely for having to delay it, but promised that they were going to bring us a better product with the extra time that they were getting to polish up all the edges. Which, I mean, not to say that it's completely, you know, fully polished, because there are definitely a lot of things that need to change, and I'm sure we'll talk about some of those in a little bit here, but overall, the game that we were given is better, at least miles better than the game that we were playing in beta. So on that front, I think that they knocked it out of the park with the extra time that they were given, or that they gave themselves, rather.
Yeah, that too. Would you guys agree, or do you disagree?
I mean, what a monumental decision, right? I mean, those guys know that we have tons of players and subscribers around the world that take vacation for this, you know, so I agree or disagree. You know, I don't really know where I fall on that. The one thing I will agree with is what Jared said about, you know, I was also in the beta, and, you know, 1 week before the original first launch date, had they released that game, I think there would have been a lot more upset players out there, because it definitely was not ready. You still had a ton of issues going on there. And then, you know, the second thing is, from a decision standpoint as well, anytime you make a big decision, you know, you're always going to have more people upset than you are people excited. It doesn't matter if it's, you know, a personal family decision or a massive corporate decision. Anytime there's a decision made, initially people are going to be upset. But I will agree, I think, you know, they got more out of that extended 30 days or so. Then I think they got more than they thought they were going to, honestly, because the game that they released, if you played beta, you know, the game they released is tenfold the game we were playing in beta. No doubt about it.
Mm-hmm. What about you, Ali? How did you feel about the decision eventually?
I completely agree with it, and I was actually shocked and a bit pleasantly surprised that they actually pulled it off. Because a decision like this isn't something that hangs from the developers. Yes, they can present the ideas to the managers and superiors, to everyone. But if everyone would say, no, you will bring it out when we say, then they're powerless. So this was basically a team effort, a huge team effort. And it should be applauded, and more companies should do things like this. Give us a product that's ready and playable and it has quality in it.
Yeah, and I think with this one, you know, I think they knew, like I've said before, they could never win. No matter what choice they made, they could never win, because it's either they release something that's unfinished or it just has too many bugs, so people will complain, or they will release it later and then people will try to find fault and go like, well, you had all this time to you know, push it back and everything and it's still not fixed. Or it would be so good and then people would still moan because it's been delayed. So in that respect, you just can't win. And luckily, however, I think that a lot of players, once they started playing, they actually realized, you know what, it's fine. A few bugs here and there, but let's face it, how many times have we not had bugs in the beginning of a game? It happens all the time. And nothing, I think, was game-breaking, at least in my experience in that sense. Okay. Let's jump to the actual Shadowlands then, and with Shadowlands we got four new zones, well actually five if you count the Mal, and six if you count Ouroboros as well with that, but we'll just go to the big zones. How how did you guys experience those zones? What were your favorites? And which ones are your least favorites? And why? Let's start with you, Ali.
Everyone said that, oh, Maldraxxus start growing on me. Oh, it's so great. Oh, it's so awesome. No. Just no. Shut up. No. Ew. No, Bastion and Arnwield are definitely 50-50 for me. I can't decide which one I like most.
Okay. Is it with Maldraxxus the aesthetics, or was it the questing?
The quest, both. I don't like it. I don't like dead things that much that actually look dead. You can be dead and pretty. Like, look at Ardenwheel. It has fairies. Come on.
You wound me.
It's okay. I have two characters in Maldraxxus. It's okay.
I would expect so with 12 characters that you at least, you know, go for a bit of story there as well.
I went with aesthetics, Warlock and Death Knight.
Ah, yeah. Would fit. Okay, well, let's go to the Death Knight. Jared, what about you?
Maldraxxus all day. answered a question from Allie from Dungeon Fables recently, where she had asked, you know, if you yourself, not your characters, were put into the Shadowlands, where would you go? I prefaced it by saying, of course, Maldraxxus is my favorite zone ever. But if my personal, like, real life body was going into the Shadowlands, I would 100% spend all of my time in Ardenweald. Because it's just super pretty, and not to mention all of the lore there is very it's very Gaelic mythology, kind of Celtic mythology centered, and I'm a sucker for that kind of mythology. Those are probably my two favorite zones out of all of them.
And your least favorite, if you had to pick one?
Revendreth. I don't see the appeal. I don't even a little bit.
Now, out of curiosity, how do you feel about the Worgen Starting Stone?
I don't see. There's kind of a huge difference between those for me, because the Worgen Starting Zone, like, yes, it's dark and dreary, but it feels more like it feels more like you're walking into, like, an old English town, whereas Revendreth just feels. It feels oppressive. Like, that's the only way that I can describe it. It just feels oppressive in every regard. Which, I mean, that's genuinely, that's what they were going for with that zone. And the story that they're telling with the Venthyr, like, they knocked it out of the park in that regard. Same with the Maw. But...
Just not your cup of tea.
Yeah, it's not there for me. And I think part of it is I may be biased on this because I've been trying to farm herbs and mining nodes in Revendreth, because they are the most expensive still today, ores and herbs, and I just hate navigating that zone, trying to find nodes to pick up. It's not a good experience.
Okay, fair enough. What about you, Squid? Which are your favorites, and which is your least favorite?
Oh, man. Had you asked me when this thing started right out of the gate, first week, I absolutely hated Maldraxxus with a passion. Mm-hmm. firstly, because when you land in the actual quest line for your first character, you know, you land in there, you accept your quest, and you have to run out this funnel, right? And there was a group of Alliance characters there that really enjoyed that funnel and got tons of honor points off of me. So, I didn't like Maldraxxus there. I don't like the way it looks. I'm with Allie. I don't, you know, dead things in game, just not my cup of tea. But then when I got to max level, started playing and realized that Mastolin and Bruheart, my two arena partners, were Maldraxxus, and that's the reason I wasn't dying as a healer. I kind of like it now. Keeps me alive. Well, you know, good old slappy hands on the DK saved my butt tons of times. I don't like the Maul as a paladin. I'm really slow as it is. I don't need any help being slow by not being able to mount up. Favorite zone, I mean, has to be Kyrian. And I even thought back whenever Jared was just saying about if you had to put yourself into WoW, not your character, but yourself, what zone would you really enjoy? And I think it would be Kyrian, you know, with all the platform-to-platform falls. And I mean, I think it would be a big adrenaline rush to be there. So, you know, without a doubt, favorite zone is Kyrian. Again, you know, it could be biased there. That's what I play. That's what I enjoyed. But least favorite zone, by far, the Maul, without a doubt. And out of the four, you know, questing areas, I guess my least favorite at this point would be Ravendreth. And it's just because to me, it's nothing is more aggravating than running around the side of the mountain expecting to see an elevator, realizing that there's not one there, and then having to backtrack to attempt to find some elevator to get up. But as far as the aesthetics, I really don't hate anything. I think the art team and everybody out there did an absolutely phenomenal job of making the visuals of the game just stunning. I mean, they've never been like this overall in an entire expansion for me. It's just everywhere I go, I'm in awe.
Yeah, and I think, you know, they've achieved to make these areas vastly different, that it really feels like a new experience in every new zone. Like, it's a completely different vibe. Even the Maw, you get a completely different vibe there from when you have the complete opposite, which is Orbus. And it just, you know, it's nice to get that. Even though I do agree, I have to say I hate the Maw at this point in time. I really don't enjoy it. But, you know, I hear that I'm not the only one with that. Okay. Let's go to Covenant. So we have two Kyrians and we have a Necrolord follower. And then, of course, myself, I'm Ardenwald because, you know, I love everything that has to do with fairies. So that's me. But was it everything that you guys hoped for? Because it was the big thing at BlizzCon, you know, they said you're going to get Covenant and it was going to be the best new thing since sliced bread. Has it lived up to the hype? Because there was also a point when people said, uh-oh, this is not going where it's supposed to be. This is going to be a nightmare trying to either switch covenants. The powers were imbalanced completely. Some people felt that they needed to go with a certain covenant because of the abilities. And they couldn't go with it for aesthetics or class fantasy or anything like that. But how did you guys feel about the covenants now that they are in game? Ali, why don't you start?
To be fair, they don't really impact my gameplay that much. Of course, they have some niches, like the ability that comes for every single class, like the covenant ability. Like the Ardenwald one is definitely the best because you turn into like a cute spirit animal and you run fast from things that want to kill you compared to the Vanthyr one where you need to sit still and cast. So I think the Ardenwald one is definitely a little bit superior. Mm-hmm. Kyrian is pretty nice. I mean, yeah, I get a guide that cheers for me. Okay, great. I'm still dying. And Maldraxxus is by far super superior if you're like in raids and dungeons because you basically get a shield that protects you. Mm-hmm. But I'm just happy they don't, like, the abilities for each class don't impact you that much. So that's good, which makes the choice a little bit easier.
Mm-hmm. Okay. What about you, Squid?
Yeah, you know, I guess I'm going to agree with Allie. You know, they don't impact my play at all. I believe that the biggest concern with the covenants out there pre-launch was that, you know, just like with anything, the big voices that we heard out there were the top 1%. You know, the guys that are doing the race for world first, and they were the ones that were having to make their decision of which covenant to play based off of what was going to be the best output. And for the rest of us, honestly, it doesn't matter. You know, I mean, as a GM and a raid leader, you know, we made very clear going into the expansion to our guild that we don't care which covenant you choose. We're never gonna bench or sit anybody based upon this. We're not gonna be saying that we're only taking Night Fae to the other side. I mean, there's nothing like that for us, and at the level that you know me and all my friends play at, absolutely zero impact, and so far have loved each aspect of the ones that I have played.
Okay. What about you, Jared?
I'm going to be the contrarian here.
Okay.
From a gameplay perspective, I still, to this day, and I think we talked a little bit about this last time I was on, but I feel very strongly that they should never have tied in new class ability powers with the covenants themselves. I think if there was one change that I would still push for, it would be just to decouple the class abilities from the system altogether, and have there be sort of like this additional talent kind of choice that you can make, that you can change on the fly, because I still very much view these covenant powers as talents, because they're kind of coded in a similar way, where it's another ability that you can choose that can affect how you experience the game from like in moment to moment gameplay, but everything else about the covenant system, I think I'm perfectly okay with, because they wanted it to be an impactful choice, and I think that they made it an impactful choice, and made it a little bit more difficult to make for people that do only care about throughput, that, you know, want to make their they want to make their numbers as large as they can. Like, it puts those people in a very difficult position still to this day. Even a month in, people are questioning, did I choose the right one? And to that, my answer is always, to that question, my answer is always, no, you didn't make the incorrect choice. Because, let's face it, everything is going to change throughout the entire expansion. Things are going to be buffed, things are going to be nerfed, things are going to change constantly. So chasing the best one isn't really a good thing to do. Like Ian has said that any time that they make like any major sweeping changes to the covenant system, there will be like a grace period where you can go and just change your covenant for free and everything carry over. That'll probably happen with every like major content patch. But for all the tweaks and changes that happen in between content patches, that could radically swing numbers for any given class. Even between like a couple of different specializations within a single class, like you can have wildly different numbers. Like for like a Kyrian, I have no idea if this is actually the case, but just as a thought experiment, like a Kyrian Beastmaster Hunter, might do incredible damage now, but they could tweak something in the Vinthir Covenant that would make marksmen do way more damage than that Kyrian Beastmaster. So now you're having to also consider, do I stick with Beastmaster, or do I switch the talents that I use and the covenant that I'm with to eke out just a little bit more damage. There's a lot more that goes into it, obviously. But I think that having the abilities themselves tied to the covenants is still a mistake. And I don't necessarily think that they're gonna do anything about that other than just, you know, change things to where everything's kind of within like 1% like damage wise. But yeah, that's my only real grievance with this system. Like, from a story standpoint, everything else is fantastic. Like getting in with a covenant and fortifying the zone and all of the fantasy that comes with, you know, building an army to take on an insurmountable thing, you know, that is top notch role playing. Okay.
Well, let's jump into this next question then as well, because this is what surprised me a little bit. So Ian, in that interview that I think most of us have seen with Preach, when he was criticizing the fact about the covenants and about the changing, that it was, people felt maybe punished if they would pick the wrong covenant and then had to swap and all of that. And there was something about, you know, the ripcord being pulled. And Ian said that that was not going to happen, but they had something in place if it really turned out sour. But then hearing that, you know, like what you said, Jared, that they've already put things in place that if changes would come to certain covenants that are that big, that it would be a grace period for players to change their covenants. I'm wondering if, are they actually not putting a ripcord in place? Because it sounds a little bit like there's a ripcord there, even though it's a little bit hidden. But do we think they made the right call by saying there's no ripcord, or now there's a sneaky tiny ripcord there that's just a little bit hidden? Jared, just we'll stay with you for the moment, and then we'll go to the others. How do you feel about that whole thing about the ripcord?
I think that their definition of a ripcord was a lot looser than anything that anyone in the community assumed that they might have meant by that. Like, given the context of the conversation that the line, you know, pull the ripcord was set in, one could infer that they were saying that if they could not get covenants to work with, you know, with soulbinds, with the class abilities, with all of that in consideration, if they couldn't get it to work properly, that they would have a state of the game that they could pull in that would kind of decouple everything. I don't think that was ever planned. I think that their version of the ripcord was exactly what we got, which is they understand that they're going to have to make changes constantly in order to, you know, make sure that everything's relatively balanced. And I think we are actually in the version of Shadowlands in which the ripcord has been pulled, because they are going to allow us to change covenants fairly freely if they make any big sweeping changes to the covenants.
What about you guys? How do you feel about everything that's been said beforehand about the ripcords and how it's happening all of a sudden now. Squid.
Yeah, you know, I think Jared hit the nail on the head. I think their definition of ripcord and ours is definitely varying here. You know, WoW has become, over the last two expansions especially, been the heavily based around borrowed power. And that's what these Covenant class abilities are, is they're just borrowed power. And what it boils down to is, I believe their ripcord, quote unquote, is based around what happens if one class ability becomes too powerful. I think that's the ripcord. I think they did the right thing not pulling the ripcord on the Covenant system. Thoroughly enjoy it. I think it makes the game what it is. But I do believe that there is some form of ripcord failsafe written in there. Just depends on, you know, what, when, where, and how big. And you know, I don't believe they should be scared to pull it, and I don't believe they will be. You know, just the whole borrowed power can get out of hand quickly, you know, and all it takes is one quote unquote Rex Troy or somebody like that to figure out the glitch in the system, and next thing you know, Blizzard's looking at it going, uh-oh, we made a mistake here, and that's where the ripcord, in my opinion, is going to come in. But you know, I love the Covenants. I think they did a great job with them all in there. To me, they've made the game super fun, and it also adds another jab in there. You know, if you have a great relationship with friends and guildmates, you know, you can jab them about which Covenant they picked, and oh, you picked that one because it's pretty, didn't you? Or, you know, whatever the case may be. So for me, I like them, and I fully believe the ripcord's there. The question is, how big?
Okay. What are your thoughts, Allie?
I think that for now it's okay to not pull it, because there is a ripcord. If we can at some point do like a free-for-all abilities changing thing, like a talent tree, where, as Jared and Squid mentioned, like have the abilities based on the talent and pick whatever you want for your class. Let's say a mage, you want to be a Night Fae because that makes sense for you as a mage, because arcane magic and fairies and everything, but you really want the, let's say, necrolord ability because you want to turn into a funny skeleton and shoot fireballs at things. Maybe you can turn into a tree and you can shoot arcane balls at things, you know? There might be a free-for-all thingy at some point, but not now. I think they're still waiting to see how this experiment turns out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think I'm very much in agreement with you guys. I think I'm sure Blizzard has something in place that if it really falls to shits with them, that they will have something there, because it is a very large chunk of what their game is built upon right now. Because there are so many things you would have to do for your Covenant at this point in time that, you know, can you imagine not having that anymore? What a world of free time all of a sudden you have with a lot of things. This is when, you know, I see my guildies just running in. Have you done your weeklies and your dailies yet? Stuff like that. But it is interesting to see our definition of ripcord and their definition of ripcord. And if it will be pulled in the future, I guess we'll have to see where the game goes and what sort of choices they make and what's planned for everything. Because we're not that far into renown levels either. We'll have to see what happens with that in the end when we get to, what is it? Level 50 or something? It's just scary thinking about it. I think it's something like that.
At 40.
40.
40, yeah. Still.
Still bad.
we're on 15 going into this week, so we'll be 18 by the end of the week. So not even halfway there.
Oh, yeah. And it's weird thinking about it like that, because I don't know, but it feels like we've been playing for much longer than a month, and I don't know if it's because there is so much to do in the game at the moment.
Yes, that's it. It is. It's super overwhelming, even for one character. Imagine more.
Wait, you're 12. Yeah, just, I get the feeling this is a very busy expansion. Like, you know, you almost need to start making planners and like spreadsheets on how to do stuff. But that's that. So we already talked a little bit about the alt situation, but how is alt leveling? Is it enjoyable or not? So we'll talk a little bit about the Friends of Fate discussion, because that was, of course, put in place so that, you know, you can work on your renown levels, it really is, it has much to do with already working on your covenant abilities and everything, instead of following the normal path as we did with leveling. And of course, leveling has changed during every expansion as well, because now we can go about it a completely different way. Or you did it as I did when Korak's Revenge was out. That's when you put all your alts in Alterac Valley, and that's how you level. But how do you feel about leveling? Now, I have to start with the mass leveler, Ali. How is leveling?
Well, the storyline, when I did it on the Pally, it was amazing. So much. But doing it on one character was it was enough for me, at least. Even if I'm a lore nerd and I read all the books and all the novels and everything, and I like theory crafting, it was enough because it's a bit slow. And I do love my polished pet charm daily quests, okay? And I need those. I need the pets. I need more pets. 1,200 pets is just not enough for me. I need more. But it was amazing, and the voice acting and the cinematics, and it like Jared said earlier, it cinematics and leveling, like, now it felt like Wrath. You were absorbed into the storyline. It was incredible. It felt like if Wrath had voice acting, like more voice acting and more cinematics. It was just incredible. And Threads of Fate, the first few characters that I went with Threads of Fate, I was all over the place. I had no idea what to do. But once you figure out a route, it's fast. And dungeon spamming is very efficient, especially now when more decent players are in dungeons.
Okay. Do you feel like Threads of Fate is... Because you said, you know, once you figured it out, is it very easy to figure it out once you've done it once, or is it a little bit like, okay, you need to hold my hand a little bit more with what we're doing here now?
Thing is, you get the zone quests and the dungeon quests, and you need to pick those up ASAP because those are a big chunk of XP, and eventually they also reward you with renown. Not all. I had a few characters where I got only to level 3 renown, and then a few characters where I got to 4. So it changes a bit, I think, with how much time passes. I think the renown levels might be given to you with each zone quest.
Okay.
It took a while to figure out the amount of quests and dungeons that I needed to do in order to complete the zone quests. So basically, it was a bit of math to do there, but... it's not very intuitive, I can tell you that. And if you don't know what you're doing, it's very slow.
Okay, okay. What about you, Squid? Have you already eyeballed some alts that you can take through the mall and level up again?
Well, if I take anything into the mall, it'll be a druid, so I can use a travel form. No doubts about that. My first character I leveled was a monk. And, you know, based off guild needs and stuff, I ended up swapping over to the Pally. I'm a healer for our guild, so we just had a situation come up, and that's where it ended. So I've only got 2 at max level. I'm not a big alt guy. I really, really like to focus in on one character and do everything to the best of my ability on that one. however, you know, I do have several people in the guild that have 5 or 6, 7 alts that are max level, and, you know... For me personally, when I did, obviously the monk went through the original storyline as it was my first character. The Pally did Threads of Fate, and I know that there's a purpose behind Threads of Fate allowing you to gain more renown along the way and more rep and things of that nature. But for me, you know, that handmade storyline for me is really the way to go. And it's funny too, because I'm not a big lore guy either. The storyline to me, though, is just, I guess for us, it boils down to what I said about the covenants originally. You know, I'm never going to go read what the bigwig guilds are saying, the methods and the echoes and limits of the world. You know, what they say is the best covenant probably is. But that doesn't matter when you're raiding normals and heroics. So for me, I think it's cool to be able to try each one of them out along the way, see what the ability looks like, and, you know, I mean, maybe I want to choose Night Fae on my monk because Feline Stomp is the most beautiful ability in the game, right? And if I want to, that's on me. So, yeah, I think being able to try out each covenant along the way is pretty cool. It's not as fast. Threads of Fate, without a doubt, is quicker. So I guess the advice there is if you're leveling something to fill a hole, take Threads of Fate and pedal to the metal. And if you're leveling something to enjoy it, just play the storyline again and play it the way it was written.
Okay. What about you, Jared?
I've only got two characters at max level as well. I had originally planned out that I was going to have four characters total at max level, that I was going to do all of the Covenant stuff. And I still intend on having four, but my second character through was my Warlock, and I kind of like psyched myself up because I wanted one level 60 in each covenant, and I had four characters picked out. My Death Knight main, my Warlock, my Rogue, and the last one was kind of up in the air, but I ended up going Priest mm-hmm. for my fourth. And I'm going to have to add a fifth because by the time I got around to leveling the Warlock, I could not see myself putting my Warlock into any covenant other than Necrolord. So I have two Necrolords now, and I've actually gotten my Rogue through the Maw intro and into the Venthyr covenant because their leather set is amazing. And then I've also got I got my Priest through so that I could start doing Inscription and Herbalism on a character just to make sure that I didn't have to, bug my guildmates for for the crafting writs for making legendary gear.
Mm-hmm.
But I think probably my favorite thing about what they did for alts this expansion, and what made it incredibly friendly for alts, isn't that they made it any easier to get to max level. Because honestly, they didn't. It's about the same that it's been in every other expansion. Like, getting another character past your first to max level is about roughly the same. The difference is that all of the professions, every single one of them, can be maxed out on a level 50 character. As long as you get through the Maw intro sequence and you get to Ouroboros, you can pick up Shadowlands crafting on any character and max it out on that character without... Well, I mean, if you have the materials, you can max it out without leaving Ouroboros. And that, for me, is what pushes... like the term alt-friendliness over the edge in Shadowlands for me is just that you can craft anything you want, anything, right out of the gate. And that's honestly like super helpful for me and for a lot of players that like you don't want to have to spend, a whole lot of time leveling characters just so that you can, get to the point where you can, craft one of the materials, like enchanting for me, getting the ability to craft the enchanted bars, so that I could send those to my Death Knight to be able to craft legendary gear. That was super important. And I did that on my Warlock before that Warlock even hit cap. Like, I just hit cap on that character like week and a half ago,
mm-hmm.
maybe, but I had tailoring and enchanting maxed long before that, like within the first definitely within the second week is when I got that. So yeah, it's all good stuff.
Okay, a question though, Because if there's one area that will always be the same that you have to do, on whether that's going to be on maybe another alt, one other alt, or 49 alts, that's going to be my future, you will always have to go through the maw. And a part of me, I know, relatively speaking, it's not a very long zone. But every time I log in with an alt and I try to do that, I'm like, oh, this again. And I bail after like the first two quests. I'm like, yeah, I'm going to do something else now. Because I think in a part, we have been so spoiled with every start of an expansion that it said, oh, I've already seen the story. Do you want to skip it? Yeah. And you just, you know, you stop that intro quest line for a little bit. We had it in Legion. We had it in Battle for Azeroth. And all of a sudden now to have to do this again and again. And I know it is part of the storyline. But how do you guys feel about that? That we will have to do the maw every single time? Who would like to start about this?
I'm not going to lie. That is one of the main things putting me off from making my last choice, my fifth choice of character to bring through, just to get into the Kyrian Covenant, which I'm not in any rush to do that. So I personally think that we are going to get a skip. I just don't think it's going to be until at least the first like major content patch, which may be coming within the next couple of months. We may be getting into it like in February. And so I think with the first major content patch, then they'll say, okay, now you can skip. But I think they want everyone to, like, everyone that's playing right now to make sure that everyone getting in is, they're knowledgeable of why they're in the Shadowlands, and everyone has that, like, that base understanding of what's going on, what's at stake. Because without that, I feel like a lot of stuff is lost. And like from a storytelling perspective, like that really beating us over the head with it, having to have every single character go through it. But honestly, it takes about like 2 hours to get through, or shorter if you've been through it a bunch of times, like I have. And I've been through it, you know, even more than the four times that I've done it now in live, because I did it a whole bunch during the beta as well. And it's fine.
Okay. What about you, Squid? I know that you said that about one other alt. How was that?
Yeah, you know, I'm okay with it right now. You know, if you turn on war mode and go through the mall, there's really no PvP in that entrance area there. So if you turn on war mode and go through it, I mean, you're pretty much guaranteeing yourself a full level.
Mm.
So, you know, you come out with only 9 levels left. I'm fine with it. I do agree with Jared. I think eventually we'll get a skip, you know, with Threads of Fate and all the side quests on the storyline. There's plenty of quests to be had out there. I know I was questing on my main character, you know, the first leveler, the monk, I was questing for a couple of hours after hitting max level before I could get into the Covenant stuff. So there's, without a doubt, there's plenty of quests and XP to be had. So yeah, I fully believe a skip is coming. Agree that it's too early. The intro portion of the mall I'm okay with. It's the everyday going down there and watching a druid sprint past me at 220%. That's what gets me.
Okay, fair enough. What about you, Ali? Because you've done this so many times now.
I've done it the first... after the launch and I did a lot of herbalism, I did take a few characters through the mall because there's a rare in Bastion that gives you on the first kill 100% chance to get an Eternal Crystal. And of course I will not turn that opportunity down, so I had to do it. And it was not pleasant at all.
Is it just something like, you just, you know, grin and bear it and just go through them all as quick as possible as you can?
The second character, I was still happy to help Thrall pick up a new weapon at shopping and stuff. I mean, it was entertaining and all, But at the 12th character, I wanted to just, no, just leave me alone, Thrall.
I think that's fair enough. Okay, so let's just go on about the storyline. We've already mentioned it a little bit. You know, does the game keep you guys engaged? And I'm very aware that we might go into potential spoiler territory here with some of the quest lines that the Covenants might give you. So if there is a spoiler, which will most likely be from the Covenants, just give out a little bit of a warning for the listeners. But what do you guys feel about the storyline? Is it engaging at this point in time? What is your opinion, Squid?
I mean, I'm definitely still engaged with it. And like I said before, you know, I'm not a big lore person. You know, I just kind of follow along and do my thing. But yeah, I mean, it's so far it's keeping me in, and you know, I'll definitely do my best to stay spoiler free, you know, as a Kyrian. But it's just been fun learning the story and going through why I'm with them, basically, you know, and not so much the why I'm with them for me, the outside of the game person that chose them, but for my pally, you know, Light Squid, you know, why is he with them and what's going on there and what's my purpose here, you know, and it gives me a little bit of a deeper bond with the character, I guess. So, you know, as far as the storyline and stuff, you know, I just being honest, what worries me though is that, you know, we're already if you're current, you know, you're already 6 of 9. This week will be 7 of 9 chapters down. So what happens in 3 weeks? Where does that storyline go? And what is my continued questing at max level other than, you know, log in, do them all, have a druid sprint past you, Torghast? You know, at that point it becomes that repeatable routine that Blizzard, I think, has tried so hard to stay away from. So, yeah, I mean, that worries me a little bit, without a doubt. But realistically, I think they did a great job. Again, I mean, I'm, you know, I hate to almost sound like a yes man or a fanboy, because that's not what I am. But, you know, agreeing with, you know, what Jared said, you know, earlier, I think if they can keep Shadowlands where it's at, I mean, this has the potential to, you know, be in that discussion for one of the best expansions ever if they can keep it up. And you know, that's where I think that a big part of that is going to be what happens after your Covenant campaign. And you know, where are they going to take that storyline? How are they going to draw it out? And you know, where's Light Squid going to go? You know, that's the big question. So just trying to keep it spoiler free, because I hate spoilers. So trying to keep it spoiler free. I'm doing pretty good so far. But yeah, the if you had any thoughts of going Kyrian, the campaign is phenomenal.
Okay. Ali, what's your opinion about the storyline and of course with the Kyrian campaign?
Well, I've played through all campaigns at the moment since I'm running all characters one by one. And what I think is very interesting is that a lot of them intertwine. So you're not just a Kyrian. You're basically semi-spoilerish, but you're not. It's not really a spoiler, because you are invaded by Maldraxxus. And you will go to see why exactly they're invading you. And Maldraxxus is going to teach you why they have invaded Kyrian, or why did that happen. So it's very, very interesting. And I think they're going to pull off 7.2. where we will get like 20 more levels of renown, let's say in the future, probably February, March, as Jared said, where eventually we'll end up flying. And very interestingly enough, every single campaign does have some wings. So I'm curious if Blizzard will take some inspiration from a very old MMO, Ion, where you actually had wings and you can fly. And I can see Jared already being excited. Thoughts, Jared?
I would 100% be here for that. if they did that. I don't think it's going to happen personally, but yeah, I think it would be super cool. Like, for me personally, I know, Necrolords have like the bone wings. As like one of the back transmog options, that would be cool to just use that. But also, I think if they did that, they would really, 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 really piss off a lot of demon hunters.
Maybe like a zone? Like a zone ability? What about that?
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, that could work. Like if like while in Maldraxxus, you just get the ability to fly. But I mean, to be fair, we kind of already have that because we have a ziggurat floating around the zone. So I think with the teleportation network, like that's the second thing that we get is a teleport to the ziggurat. And it just goes over the whole zone. So you could easily use that as kind of like a get around faster mode, and they could improve on that for Maldraxxus. But I also think just getting the ability to just fly around places would be pretty cool. Like, or like for Kyrians, like just getting your own personal, like Kyrian person with wings to just grab you by the scruff of your neck and take you wherever. Like, that would be cool. Kind of like the chauffeur mount.
Okay. How do you feel about the storyline and keeping it engaging?
So as far as the Covenant campaigns go, I'm only doing one at a time. I'm focusing on this one, on the Necrolord campaign until I can get all the way through. And then I'll pick up another one. But I think the pacing of the Covenant campaigns is pretty great. I know there are some people, at least in my guild, that feel otherwise. they really dislike the time gating aspect of the story, but the way that I look at it is that we're getting little snippets of stuff that's unfolding kind of in real time, and in the meantime they've given us, you know, 4-5 different, you know, massive zones to just go explore, and there's stuff to find all over the place. Like if you're looking, there's stuff to find all over the place. Mm-hmm. And I think that they did a fantastic job with everything. This doesn't really have much to do with the story, but one thing that I really appreciate is that the world quests seem to be a little bit more varied. Like, for example, they've given us, like, if you have a crafting profession, you now have crafting world quests that you can go out and they give you a recipe and the materials to make it, and you can use that to help, like, rank up in a profession. I wish they did more stuff like that. So Blizzard, if you are listening, please expand on that. That would be great. But yeah, like moment to moment stuff, I think it's pretty awesome. And the Maw in particular, I think, is probably one of the best zones that they've ever put out into the game. And I think the three of you have already expressed that you you all hate the Maw. But I'm going to be here to defend it, because they set out to make a zone that made you want to get out of it as quickly as possible. And that's brilliant.
I don't, because you can mine Elementium bars and Nightshade there. So no, for a druid, I'm sorry. I love it.
You're probably that druid that just goes past Quiz every time.
Yeah, if you could slow down when you pass me, I mean, that's cool. You could be speedy everywhere else.
Or just send a party invite so you can, you know, hop on.
I'm a cheetah.
But yeah, I like, with the exception of druids, for everyone else, it's a zone that you don't really want to spend a whole lot of time in. And they've done a fantastic job of making it feel daunting to step foot into the Maw. And like, it's like, if you get into it, it's really not that challenging. It's just like any other world quest. But you have that giant eye right at the top of your screen that gets really angry, the longer you spend inside the Maw. And it's just, it's a break from what they've traditionally done with in level zones, like with Suramar, for example. That was where the bulk of the story of the Legion expansion was told. Was in that zone itself. And they've done the complete opposite of that with the Maw, in that they haven't put any story in there, other than there's a broker that really, really, really wants your money. And by money, I mean Stygia. For what purpose? We have no idea. We don't know what her motivations are, other than gather item, and I will give you a other item. And that, it doesn't have to be anything more than that. Because you show up, she says, hey, go get this thing and I'll give you more of the thing. And you do it. And it works. It works from a gameplay perspective of, like, you are being sent to go get this thing. And you know if you take too long to do it, you're not going to make it out alive. And it's brilliant.
Okay. Well, with that, we have landed on the final question for this this roundtable, and I'm very curious about your final thoughts when it comes to this expansion so far, so in the first month. So what are your final thoughts when it comes to Shadowlands? Let's start with Ali.
I love it. I haven't enjoyed an expansion this much, same as Jared and Squid and you, since Legion. It has so much to offer. The story is great, the gameplay is great, the daily quests are awful, but it's okay, they'll get better eventually. I miss those Kill One Dude quests, those are the best. Mm-hmm. Torghast is still unfolding, so we still don't know exactly if we love it or we have to do it for the sake of collectibles. I'm waiting to see if it'll live up to my Mage Tower obsession. But I'll let you know next time.
Okay.
Overall, I love it. I really am enjoying myself.
That's good. Okay. What about you, Jared?
Like I said at the top, it's my favorite expansion since Wrath of the Lich King. There really isn't that much else to say other than I'm a Death Knight. They have given me tools to make more undead stuff, and the story is kind of, you know, centered around Death Knight lore, mm-hmm. and I'm loving every minute of it.
Okay, very good. And finally, what about you, Squid?
Yeah, I like Jared said, I mean, I it's one of my favorite expansions ever. It's so far, it's been great. And then to hit on what Ali said as well with Torghast, I absolutely love Torghast so far. My wife plays as well, and she's a Shadow Priest, and you know, if she gets, she doesn't play as much as I do, so if she gets busy, I'll go do her Torghast just because I love it that much. And so I'm really excited for the endless Torghast, and to see it, you know, what that plays out as. And you know, like Ali said, is it going to be something that I can dive into as like I did the Mage Tower, or is it going to be something that I stand out in front of and look at it and go, oh man, here we go again, you know? So yeah, maybe in some later episodes we can talk about Endless Torghast, but yeah, so far, great. You know, A+, I think everything that they put out has been enjoyable so far. And you know, the biggest difference to me that makes it so positive is when we were in BFA, I felt like every day when I logged in, I had a job to do and it was going to be grindy, and it didn't matter how I did it, who I did it with, or nothing mattered. It was going to be grindy and it was a job. Mm-hmm. And even with all the stuff that we have now, To me, it does not feel grindy. I feel like I'm logging in to participate in something that is truly enjoyable to me. And I think that's what the video game should be. It's my escape from reality. You know, I have a job. I have things that I already have to do. And World of Warcraft has gotten back for me to be in that escape from reality and being able to log in and truly do things that I enjoy with the people that I love. So, great job so far.
Okay. Okay, really good. Well, guys, thank you so much for being amazing guests. I'll just go by you one by one to tell the listeners where they can find you. So let's start with you, Jared. If people want to find out more about you, where can they find you on the internet?
You can find me on Twitter at JaredRPG. And if you want to hear me on more podcast stuff, you can listen to my podcast, Merely a Setback, which isn't recording until January. I think January 6th is our next episode. Yeah, we're done for 2020 and just kind of preparing for the next year. And we will be recording that Wednesday night at 9 p.m. Eastern. And if you don't want to catch the live recording, you can always find it on any other of the podcasts around on the internet, or podcasteries on the internet, I should say.
Okay, thank you very much. What about you, Ali? Where can people find you?
You can find me more so on Twitter at Ali_Eversong, and very extremely occasionally on Twitch, but that's very, very occasionally when I don't feel very anxious.
Fair enough. And what is your Twitch stream?
Same as my Twitter, Ali_Eversong.
Okay, perfect. And what about you, Squid? If people want to reach out to you, where can they find you?
Yeah, like Jared and Ali, I'm also on Twitter at Squid Wasp, WASP. That was the name of my first ship that I was on in the Navy. I don't like stinging things, just came to me. And then also on Twitch as well, which is the same, twitch.tv/SquidWasp. I stream all of our raids. We do normal and heroic raids. I stream all of our raids, and then at least a couple other nights a week, I'm on there streaming some type of PvP, rated battleground, arena, something. So, yeah, come hit me up on Twitch, join the chat, and see how truly bad I am at the game.
All right. Well, thank you all so much. And I'll make sure that all those links are in the show notes, as always. And I'll make sure that they will write it down, because I'm shit at spelling. So at least you get it, you know, from the horse's mouth and not from me. But again, thank you guys so much for being amazing guests. And hopefully in 6 months or time, perhaps you guys would like to come back and we can do a little bit of a recap of if that ripcord has been pulled or not. And if we still enjoy doing the mod. So I hope you enjoyed that roundtable, a first roundtable of the year. I'm hoping to have a few more this year. Just need to come up with some subjects, which of course I'm always open for if you want to send a suggestion. I would think that probably Twitter is the best one if you send me a DM there. Something else that you can find on Twitter, of course, is the question of the week. So if you go to whispers.of_war, that's where you will find the question of the week and all sorts of other rambling. I wanted to know this week what your favorite zone so far is in Shadowlands, and this is what you guys said. Demifernov said, I have an odd fascination with Torghast. Well, that's not a bad thing. I think, you know, if you like the endless halls, I'm sure that you enjoy the farming for the Lucid Nightmare as well. That's approximately the same thing. Longwood Rob said, never forget, and then I get a video link for Charm with Let's Go to the Mall. I would listen to that song. It's quite funny. Drixie said Ardenweald, Ardenweald. That's, I need to keep in mind, it's Ardenweald. I just love that zone. It is so beautiful and quirky, and it is and it first fits my druid perfectly. I have already taken so many screenshots. I agree, Drixie. I mean, Ardenweald is beautiful. It's very much, for me, it feels like Ori and the Blind Forest, and I love the color scheme. So yeah, I agree. And Dalaran Public Broadcasting said, by the way, I'm not singing this, Everybody come and play. Throw yourselves into that place. Let's go to the Maw today. So, Dalaran Public Broadcasting continues. Also, we say Ardenweald is the best zone. God, guys, I need to get that in my head. I don't know why I say Weld. Maybe because it looks slightly German. Sorry, I'm not trying to offend any Germans out there. But yeah, Ardenweald. Okay. So, fair enough. I think a lot of people like Ardenweald, but in all fairness, I think there are so many pretty zones in Shadowlands. I think my personal favorites are Ardenweald and Bastion. I just love the color schemes in there. It's very soothing. But I also quite like, you know, how Maldraxxus looks and the vibe it gives off. And I quite like the depressing atmosphere in where the Vampires are. I really do like Revendreth, and I don't know why, probably a bit the gothic-y atmosphere, I quite like that. So, yeah, that's the question of the week. Also, something that I might start posting on Twitter about, I am debating if I want to make the show bi-weekly. Now, this is not a thought and a decision I'm making very, very lightly. I haven't decided completely just yet. But I do notice that it's going to... you know, you have podcasts, and having done this for so long now, and I'm not talking about just this podcast, but all the podcasts I've done in the past, I notice when I start to get a little bit burnt out, and I think having done this almost every week for about a year and a half is a lot, and I don't want to get burned out at all. I want to create podcasts that I still enjoy doing and not feel like it's a second job, because let's face it, we're not getting paid for this, so it has to be a labor of love, and I don't want to fall out of love with it. So I've been thinking of maybe I need to give myself, if only for like a few months, you know, January, February, March, maybe I need to put myself onto a bi-weekly show, just because, I don't know, I think it has to do with, I hate this time of year. I'm one of those people who do suffer very much from seasonal disorder. It really affects me, and it makes me want to play less, it makes me want to do stuff less, and that's not helping when you create a weekly podcast about stuff that you should be doing in-game. And I think I just need a little bit of a resting period as well. So that's really why. I also feel like the beginning of a new year, you know, everyone, there's a lot of turmoil going on. I'm not going into political issues at the moment, but I think everyone is a little bit still, we're still, you know, dealing with a lot of stuff. Everyone is. And I think that affects all of us at the moment. So, yeah. I'm going to give it a good thought, but again, it's not a decision I will make very lightly, because I do feel like I am letting you guys down if I don't produce something every week. But even so, it wouldn't be forever, because I have periods that I sometimes want to bring out two shows a week. I had that very much last year during summer, so it could well be that all of a sudden, after maybe even a month, I'm like, oh no, you know, I really need to do a show every week now. But at the moment, I don't feel like that. So, yeah, I need to think about this. I might post this on Twitter just to get some opinions. Again, I don't want to disappoint anyone. I don't want to upset anyone as well with this. But I hope that you guys might understand why I might need to do this for a little bit. So, yeah, that's really it. I didn't want to end on like a bit of a downer note, in all fairness. Maybe I can make you smile by saying that when I fell down the stairs, my biggest priority was to make sure that the cup that was in my hand shouldn't smash, because it was my favorite Overwatch mug, which is massive, which holds like a bucket of coffee, and we cannot have that one smashed. So I didn't care that if my back broke, but I was really trying to save my coffee mug, which was ridiculous. But yeah, priorities, right? So other than that, I'm going to say thank you again for downloading and listening to the show, for all your support. And maybe next week, maybe the week after, but keep an eye on Twitter to see what I'll decide to do. But thank you so much, guys, for all your support, for always being there. And yeah, hopefully we'll talk soon again. Bye-bye.
This show is brought to you by Dragon Powered Studio. Find more at DragonPoweredStudio.com.